everybody, welcome back to my studio. And if it's your first visit here, if you're a new subscriber, thank you so much for joining us here. It's absolutely brilliant to have you on board this funny old ship. I don't know where we're sailing to, but we're having fun as we go along. I've had a lovely 2 weeks of doing absolutely whatever I felt like doing. I haven't been away, I haven't been on holiday or anything stressful like that, because actually sometimes I think going on holiday, you know, it comes with its own little things that you have to do, like pack your house up and pack your clothes into a suitcase and pack your car and then unpack it all when you come home. I've just had this really sort of simple time of getting up in the morning and saying, well, what am I going to do today? And it's been blissful. The weather's been pretty good. It's still a little bit cold, but we've got lots of bright sunshine this morning. And it's just been just lovely watching all the flowers come up in the garden and along the hedgerows when I got for a little walk. Been very gentle. I've had a lovely time, so I feel very sort of relaxed now and ready to get back into it. I can't quite remember what on earth I was doing, but I think it was something with tulips, so we'll try and get on with that today. I'd like to get it finished. I'd like to show you how it's going to turn out. I'd like to show me how it's going to turn out, to be honest. I've got my thread standing by, I've got my sewing machine ready, you know, good to go, but I have to just feel my way back into it. You know, it's just one of those things when you've had a holiday away from things, it is very much about sort of gently feeling your way back into things. Nothing too sudden. But I have to say, the other thing is, I don't know if you can tell from behind me, that an awful lot of stuff has gone from these shelves. I have had the mother of all clear outs in here. It just came upon me in the first week of my holiday that my studio was ready for clearing out. Those of you who've watched me for a while know that I did an awful lot of clearing out in the house last year because we were having some builders in, and it's kind of pushed me into looking at everything and reassessing everything. And I think when you've lived in a house for quite a long time, you know, stuff builds up in the corners, doesn't it? It kind of grows in the corners when you're not looking. And I was aware that in here, it was like getting up and up and up and up, and I really wasn't tackling it. So it just came upon me. It wasn't like my head telling me to, oh, you must tidy up in here. It was more like just something inside me said, right. And I just started taking stuff out. I started underneath tables. I pulled out things I didn't even know I had. I've been up in my loft space. I've cleared out all my old fabrics that I no longer use, because I am not doing anything like I was doing 10 years ago. You know, I'm not making any of the things I was making then. I'm very much focusing, and I want to really be clear about what I'm doing going forward. And just this thing inside me just said, now do it. So I took, you know, I've taken carloads. I think I probably started this process before the holidays, but I've actually continued, and I've got down into some real nitty-gritty. I've actually been throwing out old work, which is quite a challenge. I think when you make anything yourself, you kind of think, you get a bit precious about it, and you think, well, I made this thing. But actually, a lot of things I was just quite pleased to let go of. It's like just clearing the decks. So I've been clearing the decks, ready. So who knows what's going to come out next on this channel. We will just see as we go along. As I always say, I never know what I'm doing next. The other thing I have been doing is getting on with my work. We have got this exhibition coming up in June, which I will tell you all about. It's at Florence Arts Centre, and it's at the end of June, 24th. Of June, I think it starts, for a month through to July. So I actually have to get some work made. So I'm very pleased. I've made two pieces, which I'm not going to share at the moment because they're just very brand new, and I've got more to do. And again, I've been working quite intuitively with those, which has been exciting. So I think today, let's get back onto these tulips. Let's get them done. Let's get them. They've been missing me. I think they've been sitting over there in the corner quite quietly. And now I'd like to get on with them. I'm kind of ready to do some stitching on them. I'm ready to cut some leaves out on them. So I'm looking over there because they're over there. They're waiting on my other table. So I think just let's get on with that then. Okay, so here we go. If you've forgotten what it looks like, well, here it is. I had, I think, already cut these little stalks out last time. And I've got these heads pinned on, and I've left enough space to get the stalks stitched on underneath, so I can just flap those up. But it helps to have those laid out so I know roughly where the tulips are going. Don't want them wandering off on their own. I've got a few leaves cut, but not very many, and I think I'm just going to get these stalks stitched down, and then we'll do some cutting out of some leaves. So I shall just swivel this round a little bit. and pop that underneath there. I'm just going to get these pinned on roughly. They're bound to move a bit because fabric does, doesn't it? When you're fiddling about with fabric, it does tend to move, and I like that. I don't like things to be static. I'm quite happy if these wobble a little bit. They'll have a life of their own then, and I'm not controlling them completely. I mean, I'll sort of hold on to them when I stitch them, but I don't want them to be absolutely straight or anything like that. Although I know tulips do stand pretty straight, but I think these could be waving around a bit in the breeze. I think it's been pretty windy, and I don't like things too controlled. As I say, if I'd wanted to control things, I think I would have been a carpenter, but I'm rubbish with cutting wood and things. You know, it's just too frustrating. If it goes wrong, you're a bit stuffed, really. Whereas with fabric is so forgiving, isn't it? You can just fiddle about with it and stitch on top of it and cut it off and cut it up. And if you don't like it, well, you can turn it into something else. So there we go. Right, so I think that's over to my sewing machine and get those stitched in place. And then it'll feel a lot more secure, I think. At the moment, it's a little bit wobbly. Okay, dokie. So I have chosen a nice contrasting thread to the blue. It's kind of a, I don't know what colour you call it, sort of pinky purpley colour. And I'm going to start up at the top up here. Yes, I'm going to start at the top and then I'll work down from the top like this. Here we go. I'm just going to take it slow and steady. Slow and steady. Get those out, I think. I just want to hold it in place, really. And what I'm going to do at the bottom, I thought about whether I should go across, but I think I'm just going to go back up to the top like this. So it gets a double line of stitching like that, which I think is quite nice. It also means if your first line of stitching isn't, you know, completely kosher and straight, which it doesn't have to be, wobbly is great. It just kind of makes it look more deliberate. If you're worried about your lines being wobbly, just do a second line. It makes such a difference. It's like magic. And I don't even mind if it goes over the edge, you see. It's just nice and free. Just stay relaxed and be free, that's what I say. And we'll just lift that up and snippity snip. Snip, snip, snip. Right, let's do the next one. Okay, let's come over to this one. Okay, so you can see that I have sewn those down now. Don't they look good? I think that's so much better. It feels much more secure now. They're not all going to fall off anymore. And I think I'm not going to give them their final trim now because they might get a bit frayed in the meantime. So I'm just thinking I'll just trim them off with a little bit of capacity. And in fact, I might not trim them off completely close to this anyway. I might just might leave them dangling a bit, who knows. So I'm quite chuffed with that so far. That's really helped pull it together. I used two different contrasting threads so that I did like a purpley one on the blue and a blue one on the purple because I wanted to keep this sort of colourfulness going on. So the next bit really is to look at these heads, and I think I'm just going to get some fabrics out, cut some snippets up, and we'll see. I'm going to do the heads next because I feel like they need to be pressed down, and we'll do the leaves I think last when we've got some idea of what exactly how those look. It's very much step by step this. I don't know exactly what I'm doing as usual, but I'm just willing to give it a go. So I'm going to get my big box of fabrics, which is over here somewhere, and I'm going to just cut some snippets up and start playing with those. Okay, so let's get a bit arranged here with what we need to use. I've got a little selection of fabrics here. Just really vibrant, sort of the same sort of colours, but I'm going to mix and match the same sort of colours, the pinks and the oranges, but with, you know, a little bit of lace here and there. And actually, look what I found. Look at that. Wouldn't that be just fun to stick on, add into the mix? No, it's possibly a bit dark, but I am so tempted to use that. It just is so fun. So much fun. So I've got a tiny little bit of this orange, quite a lot of the sort of tangerine-y colour. This is like a precious piece of orange. It's about the only bit I've got that's this sort of true orange colour. And I keep looking for some, but I haven't found it yet. But I'll use this bit. And I'm just trying to think how best to do this. Let's think about this a minute. You could obviously be bonder webbing all of these things. You know, you could be putting your bonder web on the back and that would make it stay in place. But I'm just going for a free and easy look here. Again, you could have bonder webbed those down, but I just wanted them to feel like they're kind of moving around a bit. And then when we add the leaves on as well, we'll just get this whole thing going on. So I'm just going to kind of look at these and see what would go best. I think we'll put the pinks against those and the orange, and I don't know what else I'm going to put against that. Okay, so actually what I'm thinking is, what I really need to do, I think, first is actually to stitch these in place as they are. And then I'm going to add my little bits on top, because that would be much easier to do. If I try and cut little snippets and put them on, I'm going to be trying to deal with so much slippery moving fabric, I will get very frustrated and possibly quite annoyed. So I think we're going to just simply stitch around those and then they'll be held in place. There we go. That's much better. They're all held in place now, so I don't need to worry about anything at all. I'm very pleased. I managed to get all the wadding. If you haven't watched the previous videos, this has got a little bit of wadding underneath, a little bit of cotton curtain interlining wadding, so it's quite thin, but I wanted to make sure I got it so that none of that showed around the edges of the tulips. And I think that's been quite successful. I really like the way it's padded it. I think that's very successful for something like a tulip that's kind of quite blousy and full. I think it's nice to give that sort of texture to it by padding it underneath. And yeah, I think that's coming together quite nicely. You could obviously leave it like that. It's actually quite nice. You could do a little, maybe a bit more stitching on these bits and, you know, make the petals stand out a little bit more. But to be honest, that's almost a picture in its own right. I rather like it. It's got a real simplicity to it. But having said that, I do want to play around with adding some more colours on to the heads, and then I do want to put some leaves in, because I think that'll just bring it all together quite nicely. So, and don't forget, you know, you don't have to do, if you're going to be inspired to have a go at doing some tulips like this, you know, you don't have to do it the way I've done it. You can make up your own way of doing this, you know, by all means. This, I just feel like I'm here to, you know, give a few ideas, perhaps things you hadn't thought of doing, a bit of inspiration, a bit of a kickstart to your creativity. But I like to say that this is my way of doing it. It doesn't have to be your way. And it's just, for me, it's just all about playing with the fabrics until I get something that just pleases my eye and makes me feel happy inside and just goes, oh yes, I like that. So nobody else has to like what you're doing, but you know, it's nice if people do appreciate it. That's really lovely. But my main thing is just sharing what I'm doing here so that you can maybe have a go at doing something of your own version, because it'll be yours, nothing to do with me really. So I just need to cut some of these little bits now and just have a go at this, because I don't quite know how it's going to work out. I'm just playing with the fabrics, but I have to be brave and actually start. Because as I say, I could leave it like that. It's quite nice and simple. But really, I want to have a bit more play. So I'm going to fiddle around with these colours. I'll kind of do it one tulip at a time, I think. Otherwise, I might get a bit... If I try and do it on all of them at the same time, I think that might be a bit too much. So I'm just going to play around with some little sort of, they're vaguely tulipy shapes. And I could stitch them down and then cut off. If I've got bits sticking out, it doesn't matter, because I could just stitch it down and then cut that bit off. But I think I will try and trim it. I'm doing this all by eye. I think I said in the first video, obviously you could be making paper patterns and doing this all very sort of properly. Or you can just have a play and do it like this and see what happens. I feel as though this is a bit like a child with a paint box and just playing around with the colours until you get something. You just think, oh yes, that's quite fun. And I think the thing is, it's not just, you're not just doing one, you're doing a whole row of them. So you'll get this lovely colourful effect. You won't, you know, nobody's going to actually look at one individual tulip. They're going to be looking at the whole thing as an effect, and I think that's really nice. And then it's a question of what colour sort of threads you'd use to stitch that down with. And I just think that brings a bit of excitement to the, and a bit of texture to the tulip head. So I'm going to, in fact, I might, shall I do them all in one go? Do you know what? I'm very tempted to do that. You see, here I go again. If only I could make my mind up, life would be so much easier. If I could just make my mind up and say, yes, that's absolutely what I'm going to do. But I do find that making art, making whatever it is you're doing, whether it's fabric or paint or writing a poem, or even if you're making dinner, you know, I think it's about the process, and the process leads you to make discoveries as you go along. And it's also about being a bit curious and saying, well, what if I put, you know, this colour onto here? What if I did that? Or what if I do it this way? Or, well, maybe next time I'll actually do it a different way. I've learnt that that didn't work so well, but, you know, I'm doing it for the pleasure of doing it, and we'll see what happens. And then, you know, learn from what you do. I'm just loving playing with these colours. They're making me feel so happy and bright. I've been doing quite a lot of work on my pieces for our summer exhibition. And they're in a very, very pale colourway. They're very pale and very sort of gentle. And these are just giving me so much pleasure because they're popping. They're popping colours. See, I think that on its own is a bit too brash. But if I put a bit of that on top of it, that sort of knocks it back a little bit. So I think I quite like that. I think I don't want to put more than about 3 pieces on each one. I think more than that will start to get fussy. I don't want to be fussy. So I will carry on doing this, and then we'll get on to the stitching. Okay, so you can see I've pinned all of the heads on now, so we're good to go. I've tried to keep it really simple, as I say. They've got like no more than 3 little extra bits on them. And I've just played around till they looked quite, you know, what pleased my eye. So we're going to have a little go. I've probably pinned them the wrong way. I've possibly pinned them the wrong way round. I should probably have pinned them facing downwards, but you know what the heck. We'll work around that one. We can work around that somehow. We can start there. There we go. We'll just start it off there. I need to switch my machine on. So if you haven't done free machine embroidery before, this is what I'm doing. I've got my darning foot or embroidery foot on. I've lowered the feed dog teeth underneath. I usually soften my top tension a little bit, but that's, you know, that's my personal choice for my machine. You don't necessarily have to do that. You lower your feed dog teeth and just really get going. You could obviously stitch this without using free machine embroidery. You could do the whole thing just with a normal machine on a normal foot. But free machine embroidery is just so much fun to do. I'm not worrying too much about where I'm going because I feel like I'm kind of colouring in a bit now. So I'm using my thread and my machine and this fabric, and I'm kind of colouring in. I'm just taking it steady, and I don't mind that there's more than one lot of stitching going on, okay? Because I'm thinking that what I'm going to do after this is I'll put a couple more different colours of stitching onto it as well, just to bring it up to a bit more. And we'll go up there again, and you can go outside of your tulips, you know, it's up to you. I quite like to stitch around the actual outside of where I am because I think that just helps, I don't know, it just makes it more alive somehow. And it, not worrying about your edges, you know, that's the thing. It's not worrying about your edges. It's just doing the stitching. Have fun with your stitching. Play with it. Okay, so I think that's looking nice now. I'm pleased with that. And if you can see, I've done a little bit of stitching in 2 colours. I did pink to start with, and then I put an orangey colour on top. And I've tried to leave it so you get quite a lot of the sort of quilted effect through the wadding, because I think that's very sort of tulipy. But then I've tried to also just, you know, add some stitching in. It's as though you've taken the paintbrush and just painted them, and they're all different colours as the light catches the heads of the tulips. Now, you see, I think when we put these on, this will just give it a bit of grounding, give it a bit of stability, pull the eye down, but also let the eye go up to those. I think there'll be a sense of... So I am ready to pin these leaves on. I have fiddled, I have faddled, I have put them on and I've taken them off. And I've just played and played and played, cutting out different shapes, different sizes, putting blue ones and purple ones, mixing them all up. I put too many on to start with. It just looked really horrible and very dense. You know, you can imagine it with all of those on as well. And gradually I just realised that if I just keep it simple, each tulip doesn't have to have two leaves. It could have one, some crossing over, some not crossing over. And actually I decided that tulips, their stems come out of the leaves, don't they? So I thought, well, we would actually hide the stems. And I think that's quite nice as well. So I'm ready just to pin these on. And then I can get these stitched on. And that will be that. Well, so here is the finished piece. I've got a few little loose ends to tidy up here and there, and I might just tidy up a little bit round here, but I'm quite happy for there to be raggy edges. That's absolutely fine. You know, when you use fabric that you don't use bonder web or something on to hold it in place, you're going to get little loose edges, and I think that's part of the charm of using fabric, and especially when you're doing sort of appliquing onto it like this in such a loose fashion. So do let me know what you think. Do you think this worked out, you know, how I've done it like this? I actually put quite a lot on and then took some off, played around with it quite a lot. Do you like this bit? Do you think that works? You know, would you have stuck to just doing them quite plain, or do you think you would have a go at putting lots of bits of fabric on? Do let me know, because I'd love to know whether this inspires you to have a go, or whether you take this idea and you use it in a different way, or even if it just gets you looking at colour in a different way. Honestly, this has rocked my boat. It's really knocked my socks off. I know I do use a lot of colour, but there's something about this, it's absolutely just glowing. That this crazy contrast here, which I would never have come up with, just, you know, it just kind of came from the process of playing with the fabrics. Now the other thing is, somebody was asking me about framing my work, and I do that in lots of different ways. Sometimes I put these things onto a canvas. Sometimes I might paint a piece of white wood and just get that glued on. And I haven't actually done that for quite a while, but I glue it very, very carefully to make sure that no glue comes through to the front. Or I might, as I say, stitch it onto a canvas. You could even just, you know, get a really nice piece of driftwood or a nice piece of wood, and, you know, attach it to that and have it hanging. You could put some little hangers on the back, perhaps put a piece of fabric on to cover all the rough. Oh, look, there's the back. Isn't that fun? It's like a crazy drawing on the back. But you could, you know, you could be putting a piece of fabric onto there and then putting some little, I don't know, rings or something on to hang it up, so that it's literally just that, because it's got a lot of strength, this, because it's got a lot of stitching on and a lot of layers. But I think what I've decided to do is, I'll just bring this in. This is going to look a bit weird. You're going to think, what is she doing? Is she a bit mad here? I'll just maybe drop move the camera back a little bit. I don't know if you can see that properly. I've got bits of blue fabric everywhere, but I just found this frame in my cupboard, and I think that goes quite nicely in there. It's very simple, very clean, very white, and I think that sets the tulips off very nicely. So basically what I would do is I would stitch it onto a piece of mount board very carefully with some simple little stitches that nobody will see, and that will hold it in place in there. And I think that's really quite neat. I'm pleased with that. Framing it does actually make your eye, it draws your attention to the picture, and it keeps it nice and simple. I don't like glass in my frames. I have a few things under glass, but very rarely these days. I really like the actual textiles to be seen. I think glass, even if you use non-reflective glass, it's still glass. And to me, it's almost like you want to be able to touch these things, although I wouldn't encourage people to go around touching other people's artwork, obviously, but there's something very tactile about it, and I think that's what needs to shine. You need to let these stitches and these fabrics just, you know, have their moment in glory. So I'm really pleased with that, as I say. Let me know down below what you think. I'd love to get your comments. I'd love to hear what you're thinking. And I'm so grateful to you for being here. I'm grateful for your patience in waiting for me to come back. As I say, I needed a little time out, as we all do. And it's been great. I've come back and I'm full of enthusiasm now. I have no idea what we're doing next time. We will see what happens, won't we? You know how it works here by now. And if you're new, well, this is what we do. We now know what we're doing next time. Next time is next time, and we'll find out then. So thank you so much for watching. Thank you for subscribing. Thank you for being here. It's an absolute joy to be here with you on this beautiful spring day. And now I'm going to go and have my lunch, and I will see you again in my studio very, very soon.
Bye.